before we get into the technical details. So my research is actually in distributed computing, and that can cover a lot of different types of systems, you know, from multi-core computers to local area networks and all the way to weird things like, you know, wireless ad hoc networks where the participants are moving around and trying to compute something. But the common thing to all of these types of systems is that usually the dominant cost in the computation, the most expensive thing, is actually communication and not the local computation that every participant is doing. For example, if you look at sensor nodes like these, this is a graph showing the power that's drawn by the sensor. So this is what it's like when the CPU is off, which is hopefully most of the time. This is the CPU turning on. This is the radio starting to listen. And all the way up here is when the radio is transmitting. So you can see that this is actually a lot more expensive than just having the CPU there but not using the radio.
What are these guys doing?
These guys?
Yeah.
So a lot of different things. This is a really hot research area now. So one thing they can do, for example, is try to form a structure. So you throw them out there and you tell them form a circle or something like that. Or try to contain a spill where every node can sort of measure the degree of contamination in its local area. Things like this. This is actually a platform that was built by James McClurkin in his PhD at MIT.
And they can run internally any other, I mean, they're powerful.
They are quite powerful, and they have sensors and they have infrared communication, but they talk to each other wirelessly. So, for example, James says that one of the most computation intensive things when he is working with this type of network is just finding a spanning tree so that then they can gather the information that they've collected or things like this. It's not the local computation, it's more like the sort of, you know, making the network make sense. Right, and here, you know, if you think of multi-core systems, usually it's very cheap when you're operating on your own data, which is in your local cache. But as soon as you start needing to talk to other cores or to other CPUs, all of a sudden that's really expensive because, first of all, accessing the memory takes much longer, and also the bus is bounded, so you don't want to be saturating it and so on. So this is why we typically sort of ignore what's going on locally and just charge for communication or for accessing data that is not local. Yes. So yes, the original motivation for communication complexity was exactly this sort of thing. Yao's paper was called On the Complexity of Some Distributive Problems. And yes, the connection has been known and exploited for a while. Here is sort of how you do a textbook reduction from a two-player communication complexity lower bound to a distributed lower bound. So suppose we have an algorithm A, which is a distributed algorithm, and it's solving some distributed task T, and we want to show that it has to run for a long time in order to solve this task. So we're going to take a two-player problem. Here's Alice and Bob, our two players, and they're going to get their two inputs, X and Y, and now what they're going to do is imagine a distributed network. So they will sort of construct in their heads a distributed network. Typically, the way we do this is that Alice builds part of the network, and it's based only on her input X. And Bob does the same. And now Alice doesn't need to talk to Bob in order to build this part of the network because it doesn't depend on Y. And the same goes for Bob. Now they're going to simulate the execution of this distributed algorithm in their heads. And Alice can simulate locally everything that's going on inside her part of the network because she knows everything there. And Bob can do everything that's going on here. So all they have to talk to each other about is the stuff that's going across the cut between the two parts. And then, you know, we have to choose T and the two-player problem such that when you solve T, you can also figure out the answer to your original two-player problem. So for example, disjointness is sort of the most often used here. And we know that disjointness requires omega n bits to solve, which means that here we're going to need to exchange n bits across the cut. And you have to design the network in such a way that there won't be a lot of bandwidth here. So this should be a sparse cut, and exchanging n bits should take a long time. That's the textbook reduction. There have been sort of modifications and playing around with this formula. Here's just, you know, a list of things that have been done pretty recently. But the common thing to all of these is that they all use reductions from two-player lower bounds. I'm not aware of a single instance where something different has been used. And there's a pretty good reason for this, because if you think of multiplayer models that have been used in communication complexity, things like number on forehead or just number in hand communication by shared blackboard, these things don't really model distributed computation that well. So they're not sort of good for embedding into a distributed network. Now there are cases, even though two-player lower bounds are really powerful, there are some cases where they're not going to give us what we want. For example, if the network that we want to talk about is really well connected and it has no bottlenecks, no matter which way you try to partition it into two parts and have one player simulate one part and the other player simulate the other part, there's going to be a lot of bandwidth between these two parts. For example, in this case, it's going to be something like n squared. So if I have a lower bound of omega n and I try to slap it on this network, I'm not going to get anything in terms of number of rounds that are needed to do the computation. And another reason is that sometimes two-player reductions just reveal too much information for free. If I want to have the two players jointly simulate everything that's going on in the network, well, Alice needs to know the structure of the network in the part that she's simulating. And Bob needs to know the structure in the part that he's simulating. So we're giving away a lot of the hardness of the problem for free. Sometimes that's not a problem, but sometimes it is. And there's actually a conjectured lower bound that I can prove that no black box reduction from two players is going to give it. So we need something more. So that's why in this work we looked at multiplayer communication complexity. Yeah?
So you said there is a conjecture, so you tell us what it is.
I can tell you maybe offline, because it's a little bit involved to introduce and it is actually not related to this talk. But it was one of the main motivations why I wanted to look at this kind of thing. Okay, so that's why we wanted to look at communication complexity in a model that is friendly to distributed computation, so not shared blackboard, because we don't have that in distributed computation, and not number on forehead, because we definitely don't have that in distributed computation. So the model is just we have k players. They talk to each other over private channels, pairwise communication. They each have a private input that nobody else knows, and they also have private randomness. So this is the message passing model. It's been used all over the place in distributed computing for fundamental things like the impossibility of consensus. It's also used for secure multi-party computation often, because private channels are really helpful. So we're hoping that by looking at classical problems in this model, we're going to gain insight into these classical things in distributed computing. Now, for technical reasons, it's actually not convenient to work with this model, and it's better to work, obviously our goal here is to compute some global function of the inputs, and we're going to charge for the total communication between all the players.
Is there, in the two-player model, there is this reduction between private randomness and public randomness, does it work here?
Not that I know, so not in general. Possibly. Sorry? It will if your outputs are binary. So some of the problems that we're looking at actually have a larger, like they're search problems rather than decision problems. So for today's talk, yes.
For binary outputs, yeah. The same,
yeah. Mm-hmm. So for set disjointness, yes, it doesn't matter. Right. So what I started to say before, there is some technical subtlety in defining this model, just because when we look at two-player communication, or even at multiplayer communication with a shared blackboard, everyone sees the entire transcript. So it's well defined to say, well, the protocol should tell us who talks next based on the entire transcript, right? But here in this model, every player sees only part of the transcript, only the messages that were addressed to that player. So how do we know who talks at any given point in time? Do they all talk at the same time, or how do we define this? So we do have a definition. It's synchronous, and it goes in rounds. But for the purposes of the lower bound, it's actually better to think of this model. So this model is also known in the literature. It's called the coordinator model, we just have one player here who's sort of orchestrating everything. The players cannot talk directly to each other now. They only can talk to the coordinator. And the coordinator itself has no input, but it is the one that needs to know the answer at the end. So this model, in terms of communication complexity, is up to a log factor equivalent to the fully connected model. Because if we want to simulate a protocol for this model, in the fully connected model, we can just say, well, player one, you take the role of the coordinator and just do the original protocol. If we want to go the other way, say we have a protocol for the fully connected model where everyone can talk to everyone, well, we'll just have the coordinator forward messages. Everyone, you know, this guy will say, hey, I have a message for player three. He'll send that message to the coordinator, and the coordinator will send it down. So up to a factor two and the log factor that's required to say who the message is addressed to, these models are the same.
But what if everyone has a message for player three? The coordinator would have to take k steps.
But they're counting communication.
Yeah, we're counting communication and not time. Yeah, you can send messages that are as large as you want. So in distributed computing, we do care about time. But once you give me a lower bound on communication, I can usually translate it into a lower bound on time, just by saying, well, send only one bit per message or something like that. All right, so this is the model that we'll work with for lower bounds. But actually, for upper bounds, we prefer the other model, because it's sort of more natural. All right, a little bit of notation. So I'm going to use pi to denote protocols. I will also abuse notation a little bit by using pi to denote a random variable that is the transcript of the protocol. When you run it over random inputs drawn from some distribution that will fix, and it's also over the randomness of the protocol itself. And actually, one of the most interesting objects in this model is the local view of a player. So we'll denote that by pi I. It's going to be all the messages sent or received by player I, between player I and the coordinator. The communication complexity of a protocol is just its worst case communication complexity. And the communication complexity of a problem with some error epsilon is the minimum over all protocols, you know, how much communication they need. But notice here, this is in the worst case. So I'm actually not talking about the distributional setting here. I will use it for information complexity. But when I give you a protocol and I say it has error epsilon, that should mean that for any input, it errs with probability at most epsilon. And that will be really important.
So you said there are k players, each gets an n bit input.
Yes.
How do you count the input size? Kn is the total input size, or
yes.
N?
The input size is Kn.
So there's always a linear upper bound.
Yes.
There's
always an upper bound of order kn, which is just everybody sends their input to the coordinator. The question is, you know, is this necessary?
And it's easy to find functions for which it's kn.
It wasn't easy for us.
It's not, no, I mean, you can reduce it to two players, right?
Okay,
like
so.
Like inner product on the total number of bits of the first half of the player and the second half.
So it's actually not as trivial as you might think. There was a paper in SODA 2012 which introduced a technique called symmetrization, where what you do is you take a two-player lower bound and you embed it in this setting by sort of choosing one of the k players and saying, well, Bob, you take the role of this player. Alice plays everyone else in the coordinator. And if you do this cleverly and you choose a good distribution, you get a lower bound of omega nk. But the problems they can address with this technique are things like bitwise and. So you have to compute the and of all the n coordinates, right? And things like that. And their technique just doesn't seem to go far enough to address set disjointness.
No, so maybe not set disjointness.
Right,
of course,
but there are,
but
yeah.
Inner product, and if you just need the inner product, of the total vector, just to make sure I understand the model.
Yeah.
In the coordinator model, you have this k players, and the total vector of k n over 2 of the first half of the player should be inner product.
Well, but when you do this embedding, you are sort of losing too much, I think. You're saying Alice plays half the players, Bob plays the other half. Now it's just 2n, right? The input is now sort of 2n, because they can do the inner product of the entire half of the input by themselves.
They can.
Why not?
I'm not doing a generalized inner product.
Oh, then what
I'm
are you doing?
I'm thinking of the first k over two players
Oh, I see.
It's just one long vector.
Okay.
Of length k and over 2.
Yes.
And similarly on the other side.
Then yes, I agree. That's interesting. So that's sort of maybe not a very natural problem to look at, but yes, it's out there. But I mean, using two-player reductions, you can address more natural problems like set intersection, where you want to find all the coordinates that are in the intersection of everyone's sets. Okay, but set disjointness just is not sort of symmetric enough in order to do this. Okay, so here's set disjointness. I assume we all know what it means, but every player, we're going to interpret every player's input as a set, and the question is the intersection of all these sets empty or not? So we can represent this as the or over the coordinates, and inside we're going to take the and over all the players of their bit. And we're looking for one coordinate where everybody got one. What do we know about this problem? There is the very famous omega n lower bound, which is optimal for two players. Now, interestingly, in recent years, there's been interest in this problem for multiple players with a shared blackboard because of applications in streaming. So what we know, first of all, if you just take set disjointness and you look at it in the shared blackboard model, it's trivial to say that it's omega n just by reduction from two players. And it's also order of n log n, and that's also easy to see. Whether this log is necessary or not, I don't know. I think it might be interesting. For promise set disjointness, which is a version where either all the sets intersect in exactly one place, or every two sets are disjoint, this is the problem with applications and streaming. And there have been a series of works leading up to a lower bound of n over k, which is tight. The problem is set disjointness, but the promise is either all the sets intersect in exactly one place, or they're pairwise disjoint. So this makes it a little bit easier because, for example, you know that there's always a lot of small sets. There's always a lot of sets of size n over k. And that's where this, this number comes from. And this is actually a really cool line of work, which has developed a lot of information complexity tools. So it was originally proven, the tight lower bound was originally proven by Grönmeyer, but the version that's closer to what I'll do today is the note by JRAM called Hellinger Distance Strikes Back. We'll be using sort of similar techniques today. So one interesting thing I wanted to point out, you might say, well, whenever I take a problem that I know how to analyze for the shared blackboard and I look at it in message passing, maybe we get the factor k for free, just because of the fact that it's now message passing instead of shared blackboard. So this is not true, because if you look at promise set disjointness in the message passing model, you can still do it in order n over k. So this algorithm actually works pretty much as is in the message passing model. And we don't get the factor k for free. There's something more that's going on here.
Could you say how the algorithm
works? Right. So it's based on what I said before, that if I give you the promise, then a lot of sets need to have size at most n over k. Mm-hmm. Now, if I find two players that have small sets, they can just talk to each other and figure out if they have an intersection or not, right? Because that tells me the global answer. So that's what we do. We sample players until we find a pair that can just talk to each other and settle it. And you can do this in the message passing model, no problem. No, I think they actually got rid of the log factor. I'm actually not, I think that the actual algorithm doesn't have it. I'm not sure. The log factor here comes from saying, what we'll do is just every player, let's say the first player goes first, he writes all the coordinates where he has a zero. The second player goes next and he writes all the coordinates where he has a zero but the first player didn't already say them. And we go on this way until either we've covered all the coordinates and then there's no intersection, or we've gone through all the players and then there's some coordinate where no one had a zero, and that's in the intersection. And I imagine that if, I conjecture that at least randomized, you could probably get rid of the log n if you really wanted to. There is this thing for two players. Right. So I think it probably will work. But I, as far as I know, no one has verified that. Okay, so what are we going to do? I want to prove a lower bound of omega nk on the communication complexity of set disjointness. So I'm going to use information complexity tools, and I'll start by introducing them. I assume this will be familiar to all of you, but better safe than sorry. I'll show you how to design a hard distribution for set disjointness, and then I'll introduce the notion of information cost that we're going to use to prove the lower bound. We're going to first prove a direct sum, which will show that solving n-bit set disjointness is n times harder than solving one-bit AND with k players. And then we'll prove that the information cost of this one-bit AND is omega k. And that will give us a lower bound of nk on the information cost, which will translate to a lower bound of omega nk on communication. All right, so let's dive right in. And please feel very free to stop me at any point if you have a question. All right, so entropy. We all know what entropy is. Here it is. It's a measure of uncertainty of a random variable. I'm going to be using sort of an operational definition of it today. All I care about is that if you want to losslessly encode a random variable x, you're going to need the entropy of x, many bits, to do that. You can also define the conditional entropy of a variable x conditioned on y. This is the expectation over all the values of y. What's the entropy of x when we condition on that particular value of y? When you condition on a random variable, the entropy cannot go up. That makes a lot of sense. I'm sort of adding information, so on the average, the entropy can only go down. We're going to use extensively today mutual information. So the mutual information between two variables is it's a symmetric notion, and it's how much entropy I lose, how much uncertainty I lose when I reveal one of the variables to you. So it's the original entropy of x minus the new entropy after I've sort of revealed y. And this is symmetric, so you could also write h of y minus h of y given x. And by analogy to the definition of conditional entropy, we can also define conditional mutual information, which is the expectation, you know, over the value I'm conditioning on. And it's also equal to, you know, the conditional entropy minus the conditional entropy after I've revealed it, z. Okay, so there are some properties of conditional, depending on how you guys want to do this, we can dive into technical details later or not. So I didn't put a few basic properties here, like the chain rule for mutual information. If you want to see some technical details, then we will do that a bit later. And this is a notion that's been used already to get a lot of really interesting lower bounds on communication complexity through proving lower bounds on information complexity. So the idea is you sort of fix a hard distribution mu. And now you can define the information cost of a protocol in one of two ways. So you can define the external information cost. This is what an external observer who gets to see the transcript pi of the protocol learns about the inputs of the two players when the inputs are drawn from this distribution mu. Why is this an interesting thing to look at? Because the mutual information is never more than the entropy of the transcript. And the entropy of the transcript is never more than the length of the transcript. So if I can prove a lower bound on the external information, I immediately get a lower bound on the length of the transcript, on the communication complexity. Another way that you could define the information cost is to look at the internal information cost. This is what the players learn, not an external observer. So the players have x or y. So their information cost is what Alice learns, this is what Bob learns about x from the transcript, given his input y, which he already knows, plus what Alice learns about y from the transcript, given her input x, which she already has. And both of these have been used to get really interesting results. So let's see what happens when we talk about the message passing model. Can we use one of these notions, or do we have to come up with something new? So actually, we cannot use either of these, and here's why. The sort of most naive thing you could do is to say, let's take the generalization of internal information. let's sum over all the players what this player learns about all the rest of the input from the transcript, given the part of the input that this player has. But this can be as low as zero. In the trivial protocol where everybody sends their inputs up to the coordinator, the players don't learn anything about anything. So the internal information will be zero. So you might think, well, okay, maybe the coordinator has to learn a lot. Sorry?
Why this protocol?
The players don't learn anything. The coordinator learns everything. Basically, my transcript in this protocol is just one input. Right.
They also learn the answer to that.
They don't learn the answer because only the coordinator has to know it.
Oh, okay.
But even if they did learn the answer, it's only one bit.
Okay.
It's not going to give us a strong bound here.
But in the two player, there was no pi I.
No, this is a major difference.
Yeah. So it's not like what was in the previous slide.
It's sort of the generalization, because when I talk about what a single player learns during the execution of the protocol, this player doesn't get to see everything. It only gets to see its view of the transcript. So it sort of doesn't make sense to say what's the information between the entire transcript.
So it makes a big difference that you added the coordinator for this, because if there was, if you stayed in the message passing model, it might be okay.
Yes. If I stayed in the message passing model, it might be okay. But there we would run into sort of other complications. Like there is, in fact, secure multi-party computation, right, which where any set of less than half the players doesn't learn anything. So that's another technical difficulty that we have to circumvent. And that's another reason why the coordinator model is nice. OK, so this is a bad idea. But in this naive protocol, the coordinator learns everything. So maybe that's always the case. Maybe we should look at what the coordinator, who's sort of an external observer, what does he learn about the joint input from the entire transcript? So this, it turns out, can also be too small. So think of the protocol where what the coordinator is doing is, for each coordinate, he's looking for a zero in that coordinate. So he goes over the players and he asks them, what is your input, what is your input, and so on, until he finds a zero. And then he stops and he moves on to the next coordinate. So what is the entropy of the transcript? Well, we can actually compress it by just writing the index of the player where the coordinator found the zero. So the entropy is only n times log k. The coordinator only gains at most this much information about the inputs. So it's not going to give us a lower bound of omega n k. But notice that in this protocol, actually, the players learn a lot. Because if I'm a player, let's say I'm player k over 2, and the coordinator contacted me and asked me for my input, now I learned that everybody before me had ones. They didn't have a zero. Otherwise, the coordinator wouldn't have gotten to me at all. So the average player gets a lot of information when we execute.
Why does the coordinator learn only n times log k?
Because
it say log kn or something like that?
Log of kn? Because the coordinates, I think of them as independent from each other. This is also the distribution that we'll design. So I have to do this n times. And the answer is always independent, right? So the entropy will add up.
Oh, I see. OK, so.
OK, so this is just, for each coordinate, the index of the first player that had a zero.
The distribution you pick would be independent?
Only across the coordinates, not across the players.
Across the coordinates?
Yes.
The question is, I'm sorry, which problem is this? This is the disjoint?
Yes. I'm not allowing public randomness for the usual reasons, right? If you have it, then all of a sudden my protocol will not break up nicely into a product structure. But you can add it. And in fact, you know, we will sort of assume that you have it when we do the direct sum theorem. You can remove it, but not when you talk about information complexity, right? So there, it's tricky because.
Because ideally, you would want to define a quantity which is
Okay, so right, so what is the actual definition? It's the sum of these two things. So the argument is the protocol has to be bad in one of two ways. Either you reveal everything or a lot to the coordinator, or you reveal a lot to the players. So if you take the sum of these two quantities, well, this is bounded by the total length of the transcript, right? For the same reason as before, it's bounded by the entropy of pi, which is bounded by the length of pi. This here, for every player I, it's bounded by the transcript of player I. So the sum is again bounded by the length of the total transcript. So if you look at the sum of these two quantities, it's bounded by twice the length of the transcript. Therefore, if I can bound from below the sum of these two things, I get a bound on the communication. So that's sort of the right definition of information cost. Take the sum of these two things. But it's actually not the definition that I'm going to use today. I'll use something a little bit more fine-grained, which is tied to the hard distribution. And that's mostly for convenience, because it will be cleaner to think of it that way. But in the paper, we do prove that you get a lower bound on the sum of these two things. All right, so let me first tell you the hard distribution, and then I'll show you the notion of information cost that we use, because it's tied to the distribution. So when we design a hard distribution, we have a few concerns that we need to balance. So first of all, the hard distribution should have few zeros, because as we saw, the coordinator, one strategy for the coordinator is to just go looking for zeros. So if there's many zeros, it's going to be easy for the coordinator to find a zero, and that won't be a hard distribution. Right. 1 over k to make the player, the coordinator sort of have to talk to everyone. But on the other hand, 1 over k is bad because we also need the distribution to have a high entropy. If the distribution has a low entropy, the players can use sort of Sleppy and Wolf-like techniques to just encode their inputs in a small number of bits and send them to the coordinator. So we're going to need a distribution that both has few zeros but also has high entropy. And it sort of looks strange that we can do that. Just the key is to not use a product distribution. So the distribution that we'll have, it goes like this. The coordinates are independent. For every coordinate, we choose a mode, which is binary. If the mode is easy, then every player chooses their input independently. Probability 1/2, it's going to be 0. With probability 1/2, it's going to be 1. And this is sort of the high entropy but many zeros mode of the distribution. The other mode will be low entropy but few zeros. So here we choose one random player, and that player gets 0 and everyone else gets 1. So here the entropy is really low, it's just log k, but we do have very few zeros. And from the combination of these two, we get a hard distribution. So just one technical thing, the choice of a mode, you can think of it as half-half, but for technical reasons, it's actually nicer to go with a slightly unbalanced distribution. We'll see why in a second.
You're using x to denote the jth slice.
Right.
Across the players.
So xi is the subscript is a player, and the superscript is the coordinate. So yes, x super j is the jth coordinate across everyone. Thank you. Where? Oh, oops, sorry, that should be xj. Right, thanks. And you do this independently for every coordinate, right?
So again, so what happens in a typical coordinate is that we'll have about half of them once. We are doing the end.
We're doing the end.
Half of them once, and then in the remaining half will be 1 over k.
Yes.
Yes.
So this sort of blocks any
so
attempt at Sleppy and Wolf.
Guy, there'll be roughly one guy that has a one.
Sorry?
Again, so what would happen in a coordinate? Say, I mean, it might as well, we should think of n equals one. Yeah, so just one at the end. So what will happen here? There'll be...
So there is no
so
typical...
This coordinate is either hard or easy.
Exactly.
Okay, so
right.
If
it's hard, then it's, sorry, it's the other way around. I think of it as easy if it's a random vector. Right, why is this easy? Because all the coordinator has to do is sample, let's say, log k random players, and it knows the answer. In fact, the answer is almost surely 0. But in the hard case, where the answer is always zero, then it has we're going to show that it actually has to go looking for the player that has a zero. Okay, so this rules out any attempt by the players to cleverly encode their inputs and send them to the coordinator because the entropy is something like nk over 2. And in fact, we're going to show that sort of either the coordinator learns a lot about the inputs or the players learn a lot about the mode of the coordinates. Are they hard or easy? All right, so some easy properties of this distribution. First of all, if I tell you the mode and I tell you the special player that I've selected, then the inputs are independent given this information. For easy coordinates, they're just always independent given that it's easy. For hard coordinates, given that it's easy, that it's hard, and given the player that has a zero, you know the inputs are fixed, so they are independent. Now, what is the probability that a particular player has zero? Sorry, this should actually be just MJ, not condition. Wait, what did I want here? Okay, yeah. So this distribution is sort of has no bias in two ways. First of all, if a player sees that its input is zero, what does it learn about the hardness or easiness of this coordinate? Nothing. So it's still, this is the coordinator. Okay, so the coordinator can figure out MJ really quickly, right? It can sample log k players. And then it knows, is it hard or easy? If it has seen a zero, then it's probably easy. If it hasn't, then it's probably hard. So we will think of the coordinator as having the mode M. We'll just give it to the coordinator for free.
For every
coordinate, yes. Now, given that the coordinator has figured out that this coordinate is easy, let's say, then it has no bias on the inputs of the players, right? That's just by design of the distribution. But also, the reason we chose 2/3 and 1/3 for the mode rather than half-half is that the players also have no bias on the hardness of the coordinator. So given that a player got zero, it actually doesn't know if the coordinate is hard or easy because there's a probability of 1/2 that it will be easy and 1/2 that it will be hard. So what we're going to be able to show is that either the coordinator learns this or the players learn this, and in either case there's a full bit to be learned there by each player. Also, like we said, this distribution is extremely unlikely to yield a 1 in any particular coordinate, and that will be useful when we do the direct sum theorem. Remember that I said that the protocol has to have error epsilon in the worst case, not over this distribution. Yes, yes. A lot of the information complexity lower bounds do this. So we start from the worst case error, and then we sort of shift to talking about distributional distances. Okay, so here is the notion of information cost that we're going to talk about. It's similar to what we had before, but it works for this particular distribution. So we're going to talk about the sum for all players. What the coordinator learns about this player's input from its interactions with this player, given the mode M, which we think of the coordinator as having, and given Z, which we're going to condition on throughout, plus what the player learns about the modes of the coordinates from its interactions with the coordinator, given its input, and again, Z, which we're just conditioning on.
So Z are the names of the players in the hard distribution that gets a Z.
Yes, Z are the names of the special players, and we'll assume that they're out there even for the easy coordinates, even though they don't matter. Jelani?
Yeah, I wanted to remind you also what Z was.
Okay, yeah. Z is the zero player. Okay, and M is the mode.
Color, it's a vector.
Z is a vector.
Yes, it's a vector. Everything here is a vector. But soon we're going to talk about single coordinates, so there, you know, it won't be. Should be what?
A one.
Oh, yeah, you're right. I'm sorry.
It looks like I'm in the
hard,
easy
mode.
I'm sorry. Yeah. So as you can see, this is the first time I'm talking about this result. So you guys are my test case to find all the typos. Thank you for your unwilling cooperation. So yeah, this should actually be a 1. It's sort of, if I get a 1, I am not helpful to the protocol because the coordinator is looking for zeros. And that's why when I, we're going to show that when we condition on x being 1, you still have to learn if it's easy or hard. Okay, so this is actually what we're going to show. For every coordinate j, either the coordinator learns a lot of the inputs, even though the coordinate is easy, right? So it doesn't really need all these inputs, but it's still going to learn them. That's one way for the protocol to be bad. The other way in which it can be bad is that these players that got a 1, right, so they are not contributing to the search for a 0, they will have to learn if the coordinate is hard or easy. So if they want to do any sort of clever encoding, they first have to figure out which are the low entropy coordinates. And they can certainly do that, but in order to do it, they have to learn which coordinates are hard and which are easy. We'll show that either this is big or this is big. In the worst case, absolutely, which means that it also does it for this distribution. But this distribution is, in terms of error, it's really easy because the answer is almost always 0. That's why we're assuming that the protocol for every input, even extremely unlikely inputs, it has error at most epsilon.
So you're not using the next?
No, I'm not. Okay, other questions? All right, this we call it switched information cost just because, you know, of this switch that we put in, which makes it hard or easy. All right, the first thing that we are going to do, and this is sort of the standard way one goes about these lower bounds, is to prove a direct sum theorem. So we want to prove that the information cost of solving set disjointness with n bits and k players under this product distribution, all denoted by mu to the n, where mu is the distribution on a single coordinate, well, it's as hard as solving n copies of AND with a slightly higher error and the hard 1-bit distribution.
No, that's not slightly, so the result doesn't work beyond more than longer players.
That's true. No, sorry, this is a relationship between n and k.
I understand. So more than log n players, you're the other way.
Log k.
You need k to be huge for this.
Right. So this is
you
a.
You need k to be huge.
Yes.
For a small number,
first of all, for a small number, even the naive n lower bound is already within log of optimal. Yeah. And second, I believe that the distribution can actually be tweaked to get rid of this error. But I haven't done it yet, so I wanted to give you the version that I know is true.
Yes.
Let me show you why the error grows. So what do we do to get a direct sum theorem? I assume that I have an n-bit protocol pi, which solves the n-bit problem. I want to construct a 1-bit protocol. So obviously, I have to run the n-bit protocol. I'm given a 1-bit input, so I'll just choose a random coordinate, and I'll put my input in that coordinate. And now the question is, how do I sample the other coordinates? How do I come up with an n-bit input? And this is a little bit tricky. So one thing we can't afford to do here is to sample the z's, the zero players, the special players. We can afford to sample them publicly. So for example, say the coordinator samples this and he sends it to everyone. That's okay because we're conditioning on z throughout, so it's okay to reveal this information. But how do we sample the actual inputs? So one idea might be to just have the coordinator sample them and send them to everyone, like with Z.
Well, wait, about the selection of Z, what do you mean sends Z minus J? They don't know the J's position.
They do. That's also public. So the coordinator chooses it, sends it to everyone. Thanks. Yeah. So that's public, and also these are public. They need to know the J in order to know sort of what we're doing, what is the input that we're constructing. So the first bad idea is to have the coordinator sample all the inputs. Now this is bad because it's giving away for free a lot of information about the inputs. The classical example is an XOR. Every time I talk to Marco or Marie, they always bring up this damn XOR. So if the protocol, what it does is takes the XOR of all its coordinates, and now I gave everyone all the inputs except the one coordinate that I care about, then by just sending this XOR, I have revealed the one coordinate, right? So it's leaking more information than we want. So that's a bad idea. So the next idea you could think of is to say, well, why don't we have the coordinator sample just the mode, decide if every coordinate is hard or easy.
Could you repeat this X, for example?
Right, so say that my protocol is every player takes this vector of n bits and takes the XOR and sends that to everyone. Right, sends it to the coordinator who forwards it to everyone. So the original protocol leaks one bit about these n coordinates. Therefore, I want my protocol to leak 1/n bits. But in fact, this is not what it's doing, because everyone knows all the other coordinates, so they can recover my coordinate from it. So I'm leaking 1 bit, not 1/n bits. Okay, and this is a usual obstacle that comes up in pretty much every direct sum theorem. So what we need to do is have some private sampling in here. So you could say, well, why don't we have the coordinator sample hard or easy for every coordinate? Now, given M and Z, the inputs are independent. So we can have every player just privately sample its input. But this, again, is leaking too much information, because maybe my protocol is of the type where the players learn a lot about M, and now I'm giving M away for free. So I will again be leaking too much information, and this is also not a good idea. So what we have to do, we don't know if the protocol leaks a lot here or if it leaks a lot here. We just have to hedge our bets and sort of do half of this and half of that. So this is what we're going to do. This is what we had before. We sample the special players publicly. Now, the coordinates up to J, we're going to do the first thing, where the coordinator says it's hard or it's easy, and it sends that to all the players. And in the coordinates starting from J on, it will sample the inputs, and it will give them to the players who won't know if they're hard or easy. Now, once every player gets this information, right, so notice that it's only getting its own input here, it's not getting everybody else's inputs, then it will privately sample the things that it's missing, which is all these first inputs here. And through the magic of the chain rule for mutual information, this protocol can be shown to actually only leak 1/n of the information. So this part I didn't put on slides because the notation is kind of messy. You can see all these random variables here. If you want to see it, we can do it on the board. But actually, given the time, I'd prefer to move on. This is somewhat standard by now to use the chain rule in this way. So no, the protocol is in the worst case, right? So you give me any input.
We want to do it in the worst case on one coordinate. So the distribution in that this coordinate will be from you. So that you don't worry about.
Say again?
The distribution of the instance
that we actually got.
That you want to solve is drawn from you.
No, it's in the worst case.
You want the protocol to work in the worst case.
Yes. Mu to the n.
No, so what you are going to, you are reducing it using 1. And this 1 is also under mu.
Okay, the hardness. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, I thought you were talking about the reduction. Yes.
It's supposed to work in the multiverse.
Yes, the hardness that we'll show is under mu, and then sort of the direct sum lifts it to hardness under mu to the n. But for purposes of error, this is where the error creeps in. So I get this worst case input that I'm embedding in the jth coordinate. But when I draw all the other coordinates, there is a small chance that one of these coordinates, the and will be 1. What is the chance of that happening? It's 2 to the minus k for every coordinate. So it's n times 2 to the minus k of having some other coordinate which will be a 1. If that happens, then I won't know the answer on the coordinate that I cared about. That's why the error goes up. Exactly. But with high probability, all the other coordinates will come up zero. So when you take the OR, the answer will be the one thing that you really did care about.
So the way you would like to tweak the distribution is just to condition on...
Exactly. The way I would like to tweak the distribution is to have the Z play even when it's easy and just say, well, this special player, he gets a zero. Now it's always going to be zero in all the coordinates and there will be no increase in error. It's just that for the one bit case, you know, I haven't gone through it. Okay, more questions? Because this is pretty much all I wanted to say about the direct sum. All right, so now there's nothing for it. We have to roll up our sleeves and show that one bit AND with k players is omega k bits of information. So let's fix a one-bit protocol pi that we're going to analyze. And remember that it's extremely unlikely that we're going to get a one answer. But this protocol has to be good for all inputs, even the ones that are very, very unlikely, even 1 to the k. And in fact, if you give me two inputs, x and x prime, where the AND differs, so one of them is 1 to the k, the other one is anything else, then the distribution of transcripts on these two has to be different. The protocol has to tell the difference. And this, we're going to use it in the proof, and the question is, what is the notion of farness that we want to use? There are many options that we can go with. So the distance metric that I'm going to use here is Hellinger distance. Here is the definition. So this is actually the square of the Hellinger distance. And this is also the one that's been traditionally used in this line of work on multiplayer set disjointness in the shared blackboard setting. So the reason we want to use this is that here we have the product of the two distributions. And that leads to some very nice properties when you talk about communication protocols because they have a product-like structure. So what do we know about Hellinger distance? First of all, it's a metric. So in particular, it has a triangle inequality, which will be useful. And second, when you talk about communication protocols, it has it breaks up nicely. So here's one property. Let's say I'm looking at two inputs, and I break them up into two disjoint parts. So one part is x1, x2. And then I break them up the same way into y1, y2. Okay, so I take some of the players, they get x1 or y1. And the other players get either x2 or y2. And now I can also look at what happens when I switch things around. And I give the first set of players, I give them x1, but the second get y2, and vice versa. So this is a combinatorial rectangle. And we know that for a deterministic protocol, these two things will have the same transcript, if and only if these two things have the same transcript. In other words, the distance between these two transcripts is the same as the distance between these two transcripts. And the nice thing about Hellinger distance is that this intuition carries over to randomized protocols. So under Hellinger distance, the distance between these two distributions on transcripts is the same as the distance between these two distributions. And this is called the cut and paste lemma. It's from Bar Yosef et al. The other property that we're going to use. For any partition, yes. So they proved it first for two players, and then you get the multiplayer lower bound by easy reduction. The other property is something that I call the C lemma. It, again, follows from a property that was shown by Bar Yosef et al. It's not quite what they used. So take any rectangle, and take any sort of three sides of it that are adjacent. Then the sum of these two sides is at least as big as this side. So take any C shape, the first two sides are at least the third in Hellinger distance. And this is pretty much all we're going to use in terms of actual distances. So we do need a way, though, to relate Hellinger distance to mutual information and to what the protocol is doing. So here's the properties that we need for that. First of all, if you give me two inputs where the answer is different, remember we said they have to be far apart. So this is how far apart they have to be. The Hellinger distance between the distributions on their transcripts has to be at least, you know, as well as the protocol is doing, divided by some factor. And the other connection is that this is a connection to mutual information. So suppose we have two distributions, mu0 and mu1, and I'm going to generate a random variable by choosing one of these two distributions, so I choose 0 or 1 equally, and then I draw a random variable from the distribution that I chose. Then my ability to tell which distribution I chose by looking at the sample from it is at least the square of the Hellinger distance between these two distributions. Okay, so it makes sense because the farther apart they are, the more likely I am to know which one you actually used to draw R from. Okay. So we're going to first start by showing that the protocol really has to find which players have zero. Although this is not part of the problem, right? Because all you have to do in the AND problem is find if there is a zero. But I want to say that when M is 1, when the coordinate is hard, then pi has to informally identify where the 0 is. Why is that? Well,
it's more or less like the random access
code. I don't follow.
Well, I'll tell you if it's related to where M is
0. Okay. So just in terms of notation, let me use chi A to denote the input where the players in the set A gets 0 and everyone else gets a 1. And let's look at this rectangle. So here, two particular players, I and J, are the only ones who get a 0. Here, nobody gets a 0. And here, I and J both get a 0. This is a combinatorial rectangle. If I take any partition where I is separated from J, I get this rectangle. And by the correctness, the worst case correctness of the protocol, we know that the distance between these two distributions has to be big, because the answer here is 1, and the answer here is 0. Now we can apply the cut and paste lemma to show that the distance between these two distributions has to be big. So the protocol has to tell the difference. Is it player I who had the 0, or is it player J who had the 0? Right? And in fact, we're going to take it one step further. And we'll use the triangle inequality to show that the sum of these two things has to be at least the diagonal. So for any two players that you take, either the protocol can tell whether only player I had a 0 or both I and J had a 0, or it can tell whether only player J had a 0 or both I and J had a 0. So this is going to be useful in a minute. Let me define by gamma I the protocol's average ability to tell if only player I had a 0 or if player I and some random player Z had a 0. Okay, so it's the expectation over other players Z of the distance between when only I has a 0 and when I and Z both have a 0.
So how is Z
uniformly. It's the same Z. It's from 1 to k uniformly. Yes, this is for, it's the distance between only player I gets 0 and players I and Z get 0 and everyone else gets 1, right? So intuitively, if you just look at the definition of AND, there is no reason why the protocol should be able to tell the difference. But what we just showed is that, in fact, it does sort of tell the difference. So if you square this and take the sum over all players, you're going to get that the average player has a high difference. So we call this the usefulness of player I. So on average, yes, the protocol can tell if only player I had a 0 or if some other player had a 0 as well.
Actually, why do you would you go back one slide?
Yeah.
Actually, why do you use the Hellinger inequality? Why not just use the diagonal and in the next slide?
Sorry.
No, it's okay. In the next slide, you could just define gamma I to be the expectation of the Hellinger distance between chi I and chi z.
I could, but actually, this is what I'm going to need. I know it's a little bit counterintuitive, but I will need it when I talk about one player. Okay, so this is the very next thing that we're going to do. So this is sort of a global property of the protocol. Now I want to talk about one player. What does it contribute to the information cost? So here I'm going to lie to you a little bit because the technical details are a bit messy. So remember how we said that the xi's are actually independent, conditioned on m and on z? It means that this partition thing that we did, where we built a rectangle that was partitioning the players into two parts, you actually can extend it to rectangles that look like this. So here, I'm sort of partitioning by saying I look at player I versus everyone else, but I don't really commit to a particular input for everyone else. Instead, I'm just going to condition on the coordinate being easy. Right? So the inputs are independent, so what I'm doing here is sort of averaging over everyone else, given that the coordinate is easy. No, here I'm looking at the distribution of transcripts, condition on xi being 1. Now, in the triangles we saw before, I would also be conditioning on x minus I being a particular thing. But what I'm saying now is that I'm allowed, instead of doing that, I'm allowed to condition on just the coordinate being easy, and that's like summing over all the possibilities for easy things. So I'm like looking at a lot of rectangles at the same time, sort of superimposing them together. And here I'm conditioning on the coordinate being easy and player I getting a 0. Here I'm conditioning on the coordinate being hard and player I getting a 1. So this is the all 1 input, except that player Z, who is in the background, he gets a 0. Right? Remember, we're always conditioning on Z. And what happens here is almost like saying, well, M equals 1 and XI equals 0, which would complete the rectangle. Except that that's not well defined, because when m equals 1 and z is not player I, this thing is not well defined. So I'm just going to look at the input where both I and z get a 0. So this is the rectangle that we've set up. Now, what we said before, this was defined to be, the distance here was defined as the square root of gamma I. We said that gamma I is the average of the square of the Hellinger distance. We'll see why we use the square in a second. So if you take the square root, that's like the average distance here. And I am lying to you here. This is not really the way that it goes, but intuitively, this is what it is. So now we're going to apply the C lemma and look at these two sides of the rectangle. And their sum has to be at least the square root of gamma I.
So gamma I is typically a constant, some constant.
Yes, for an average player, it's a constant. Now, why do I want to talk about what these two sides? Look at what we're doing here. In one case, we are drawing a transcript from the distribution condition on m being 0 and xi equals 1. In the other case, we're drawing from m being 1 and xi being 1. So this should remind you of something that we were doing before, right? Drawing from one of two distributions. And the question is, can we tell which distribution it was? So in fact, this Hellinger distance is directly related to the mutual information. The mutual information between the mode, which is the only thing that differs between them, and the transcript pi I, which is what I'm drawing, condition on xi being 1, is at least the square of this edge. And the same thing goes for the other edge. So now I'm keeping the mode easy, and I'm varying xi. So what we have here is the mutual information between xi and the transcript that I draw, condition on the mode being easy. Question? Absolutely.
The sum of, because this exactly the sum of the two sides corresponds to the information cost is switched.
Yes. So that's exactly right. So we wanted to talk about the sum of these two things, and we had here the sum of these two edges, so we're already very close.
Could you give an intuition for why the C lemma follows?
Okay, so the C lemma actually comes from the Z lemma of Bar-Yosef et al. It's again, what you do is, I'm sorry, I know this is ridiculous, but I don't really have a pictorial intuition for it, but the way you always approach these things is you say, I can look at the protocol's distribution on transcripts as sort of a product of two quantities, one depending on one part of the input, the other depending on the other part of the input, and then the Hellinger distance sort of works very nicely with this because it has the product there. So the Z lemma says if you take a diagonal, it's at least as big as the two sort of support sides. Mm-hmm. And then when you add the triangle inequality to that, you get the C lemma. Okay. So I'm lying to you in a lot of different ways in this picture. One is this thing where you cannot actually talk about the average distance. You have to commit to a particular Z, talk about that one, then take the average. Another way in which I'm lying is that we define gamma I as a distance on the global transcript. So how come now I'm talking about one player's transcript? So the answer is you can localize the distance and say if there's a large distance in the global transcript and we're keeping everything the same except one player's input, then it translates to a large distance in the local transcript as well. And those are just some of the ways I'm lying. In some ways, yes, it's a direct sum over the players.
Is it an obvious thing, or is something that requires, I mean, it's as natural as it sounds, or it's, I mean, the total, what you get from each individual transcript is...
It is very natural, as easy as it sounds, once you have this property that, you know, M and Z encapsulate everything I needed to know about the other players.
So the independence of the input.
Exactly. No, because I'm keeping everything else the same. So I'm conditioning on M and Z, and I'm varying Xi from 0 to 1. Why would the transcript possibly be different if player I is saying the same things? Okay, so it has to be that player I's distance is causing the distance in the entire transcript. And it's not hard to see, technically. Okay, so let's wrap up. What we get here by taking the sum is that the sum of these two mutual informations is gamma I, the factor 3 comes from all my lying, which I didn't tell you. So this is what I said I was going to show before. Either the player is not helping me find a zero, but he still has to learn if the coordinate is easy or hard, or the coordinate is easy, but I still have to learn the player's input. So now we're just going to get rid of the particular conditioning here. So these are high probability events. The probability that Xi is 1 is 1/2. The probability that the mode is easy is even higher. So when we take the expectation over Xi, we will be left with a constant fraction. So that's what we get here. And now we just have to sum over all the players. Remember that the sum of the gamma i's, we already showed that it's large. So when we sum, we get that the switched information cost of the protocol has to be some constant times k. And because the information cost is this high, we also get the corresponding lower bound on communication complexity. All right, if there's no questions, that concludes the technical portion.
Yeah, so could you go back one slide? Is there some simple intuition for what this part of the argument is doing? I mean, in the previous part, you gave the intuition that this shows that you have to find the zeros. So some simple intuition for this part?
So really, this is the intuition that I have for it. It's sort of, take the contrapositive. If the player doesn't learn that the coordinate is easy, but he's also not telling me his input, then I shouldn't be able to tell if he has a zero or not. Right, so this is sort of what we're doing here. Starting from the fact that yes, I can actually tell that in going back. Okay. So just to conclude, we introduced this funny notion of information cost and we gave a lower bound on it. You can go back and show that from this lower bound, you get a lower bound on the true information cost, right, which is not tied to these M and Z. And we get a lower bound on twice the length of the transcript. The two comes from just summing, you know, this and this. So in some sense, oh yeah.
If you were not in the coordinator model, but in the original model, wouldn't it be the sum, wouldn't it be the information a player learns from the others in the protocol plus the information they learn from it?
Yeah, the information that I leak plus the information that is leaked to me. But I actually am not confident that this would be easy to analyze, again, because of the secure multi-party computation protocol. Okay, the one reason why it might be okay is that my partition takes one player out versus all the n minus one, right? So there is no security for the n minus one. But I think...
It is eventually an individual.
Yes. Yes, it is.
So there's sort of a direct sum on the information cost as a, on this information cost.
I wanted actually for there to be an explicit direct sum on the players, but I have not been able to make it stick. I did need sort of the global property to start from, where we bounded the sum of the gamma i's, and then we're able to go back and talk about the individual players. Not direct sum over the players. In the sense that...
Not direct sum over coordinates.
Coordinates, yes.
Coordinates is not a problem to prove a direct sum for this standard network model.
No.
Private channel. There's no problem.
No problem.
Right, so...
Again, provided you do the sampling this way.
Yeah, provided you do the sampling. So now we are stuck with just proving something for the end of K bits for this K player.
Mm-hmm. Or he leaks, yes.
And this you don't know how to do directly in the...
Oh, I haven't tried. I do imagine that it would probably carry over, though.
It's not that it seems a bit more natural, I mean, right, both are natural, the coordinate model is clearly elegant and natural, but it seems like, it's a very natural measure to say, you know, for every player, how much he leaked, how much he got.
Yes, but there are technical sort of, so remember I said that synchrony is an issue. When we define the fully complete model, then we have to introduce rounds. We have to say everybody sends a bit to everyone else, then we start the next round. Otherwise, I just don't know how to define a protocol.
I mean, since you don't care about time, you divide.
But if you don't care about time, there is a protocol that takes exponentially long and exchanges only n bits. Okay, so you do have to care about time.
No, not exponentially. I mean, if you can just schedule them. You know, player one talks at time one more n, one more k. Player two talks at time two more k and sends bits to the other. I mean,
but how do the others know what the time is? So the problem is, as soon as you introduce synchrony, though, I can do long coding. I can wait until round two to the whatever my input is. Okay, so you have to add this restriction explicitly to the model, and we didn't want to do that. We wanted to have, we didn't, you know, want to worry about that as well. That's why working with the coordinator model was nice for us, because it has transcripts the way we like to think of transcripts. We don't need to introduce rounds. And we can prove that it then goes back to the message passing model with the rounds.
But you lose the log n
factor. Yes, you lose the log n k.
You need to forbid private randomness of any kind, and even then it's...
You seem to do it by this roundabout way, so there is so it seems like the, I mean, at least it seems to me that the cleverness is in the measure of information that you choose. Right?
Yeah.
In the switching, whatever you want
yes,
to call
it. Yes, but it's an accounting trick that...
It is an account, yeah, but I mean, that it implies a lower bound on the information
yeah.
each player is, you know, leaks and gets back. So it implies it, so it should be true. It is true in the private channels model.
I'm with Avi here. I think that it would work.
But do you believe
the secure multi-party worries only about what players learn, not how much they leak. I find that, you know, the
so
key idea here is
right.
that you...
So how much they leak, it's not like on this majority, because it's
exactly.
n minus 1
and this is this seems to be the major change. I mean, everybody was stuck with the multi-party because everybody was, you know, I
So yes and no. This, I cannot defend it in that sense because it seems to be a little bit ad hoc, right? I gave you this hard distribution which has the switches and everything, and they are explicitly reflected in my notion of information complexity. So intuitively, I think it's a good class of distributions to work with. They seem to work well, but there is no sort of Platonic justification for this. But on the other hand, if you look at the sum that we had before, just the information that I get plus the information that I leak, then yes, I think that's the right notion of information. And once you guys figure out compression for two players, then come talk to me and we'll talk about
it. Yeah, no, it seems like you did describe how to do to publicly sample the rest. So now
yeah.
It's a matter of trying to do a mark in a loop for three parties.
Yeah. So I don't think it will be immediate because all the sampling that's going on there, now you have to do it for K players. I don't know if it will be that easy. You know, figure out when we were wrong and all of that. Okay, let me finish up with just sort of a direction that I think is interesting. So in some sense, what I showed you here is like a warm-up. It's like baby steps. It's a model that's already very close to models of communication complexity that we understand. But the real model that people in the distributed computing community worry about these days is a model where we have some arbitrary network graph, and nodes only talk to each other directly if there's an edge between them. And the bandwidth on each of these edges is bounded. Okay, so it's a general network graph. Can we show some bound of more than NK if players cannot talk to each other directly? So if this guy wants to talk to this guy, this person here will need to forward that message and spend more communication. So as far as I know, there are no lower bounds of this sort. They would be really interesting.
For any problem?
For any problem. Not that I know of.
What graph do you assume is a problem? For circle, it's also not known? Or
I don't know. So it wouldn't need to be a circle. I would expect it to be something for a class of graphs or something like that. And let me give you an example of one problem where this can be useful. So suppose that I have an arbitrary, directed, and strongly connected network. And what I want to do is find a rooted spanning tree. Just find any rooted spanning tree. And what it means to find a spanning tree is that every node needs to know which of its incoming edges are its children and which ones are not. So the input to every node is just its incoming edges. It knows which edges are incoming. That's all it knows. The rest of the graph, it doesn't know it. And what I want to do is select a subset of these and output them and say, these are my children. Sorry?
This is in some sense a complete problem. Once you have that, you can forward everything down the tree.
Yes. Once I have a tree, I'm able to compute a lot of interesting functions.
And in
n times k, yes. But there's a lot of okay, that's an interesting point that I didn't think about. The reason I'm thinking of trees is that usually when you have a sensor network or something like that, you want to compute some aggregate, some average or a maximum or something like that. And you do that on top of a spanning tree and faster than NK, right? If I'm counting, I just sum up the tree and so on. That's a really interesting point. Yes, that's what makes it, that's part of the hardness of coming up with a lower bound, that these things are tied together, and we don't know how to address that. So what we do know how to do is slap a two-player lower bound on it. So this appeared in a paper of mine in 2011, and it's using said disjointness, or a slightly harder problem, to show that it takes n over b rounds, where b is how many bits I can send in one message. But this is a really sparse network. It only has order n edges, and this is tied for this class of networks. And I don't know how to address the general case where the network is not sparse, where it is somewhat dense.
I mean, maybe for sparse, there is an n log n.
For sparse networks, this is tight. If you give me a network with order n edges, I can do it in order n over b. But if you give me a network with any number e of edges, I know how to do it in order e over b. Because
yeah,
remember,
just said that there is a linear upper bound. So
there's a linear upper bound on the rounds. It's not on communication. Because
this upper bound is not on communication.
It's the number of rounds.
Oh, you, so you don't know a linear upper bound even for sparse networks.
Yes.
Okay, so that's why.
Oh, okay, thank you. Yeah. Right, so what's going on here is that in every one of these rounds, every node is sending b bits. So it's actually n squared over b. And in general, I would suspect that this carries over to dense networks. But I can argue informally in this case, not prove, that two players, a reduction from two players, you know, will not give you anything more interesting than this.
So what about the
whether it's a, I don't know. I don't know. There is work on sort of, what did they call it? Distributed verification, which is this style of thing. But they haven't looked at directed graphs. It makes a really big difference if it's directed or undirected. So you're never going to get a linear bound if the network is undirected. You know, something of the form n over b. A lower bound, just because undirected networks are easy for many reasons.
So you can tell the answer to the question I asked in linear number of bits?
I don't know.
I am asking about bits, not wrong. Just whether it's connected or not connected, whether it's a permutation, cyclic permutation, or
then no, I don't know, and I suspect that it's connected to questions about local computation. What can I compute about the graph by only talking to my close neighbors, because if you restrict me to a linear number of bits, I cannot.
Exactly, yeah, this is what I was going to use. There are
yeah.
Such lower bounds, like
yes.
There are n log star n, but log star on the lower bounds on the distance, so don't they imply this?
I don't know. That's an interesting direction. Okay, so this is one maybe representative problem. There are many more where this came from. In general, in distributed computing, because information complexity is sort of new, a lot of lower bounds just say, let's assume that in every message, you send messages of this particular form. First your ID, then this, then that, and then we'll prove a lower bound on that. So it's interesting to take these lower bounds and see if they carry over to a more general setting where I can send whatever I want in every message. That's all I have.